The Rosicrucian movement is a mystical fraternity which, by necessity, operated in secret for much of its existence. It claims that its roots originated in ancient Egypt from the time of Pharaoh Thutmose III, who organized the first esoteric school of initiates founded upon principles similar to those perpetuated today. Some modern researchers, however, assume that the Rosicrucian movement originated with a group of German Protestants between 1607 and 1616, when three anonymous documents were published in Europe. They were called Fama Fraternitatis, Rosicruciscus, Confessio Fraternitatis, and Chemical Wedding of Christian Rosenkreutz, anno 1459.
In 1886, Professor Van Scrom of Naples, Italy, was experimenting with the bacilli of the Asiatic cholera and was examining the same under his high-power microscope.
He was attracted by the formation of double pyramids of bacilli in the shape and general appearance of true crystals. These living crystals manifested growth and movement and seemed to be alive and conscious. From these experiments, he arrived at the conclusions that all bacteria produce living crystals, and his continued experiments seemed to verify his contention. These bacteria crystals are composed of homogeneous albuminous matter, which at first is colorless and structureless, and which at a certain stage of their life history seem to lose their life qualities and to become, to all intents and purposes, dead crystals. These living crystals seem to be impelled by some inherent force akin to vital action to assume a geometrical figure.
And while possessing these indications of elementary vegetable life, they also exhibit the characteristic qualities of crystals, namely refraction, inclusion, absorption, and polarization. Later investigations have revealed the presence of similar living crystals in the secretions of living organisms. That life is present in plant life, scarcely anyone is disposed to question, though there seems to be a desire to deny consciousness and intelligent activity in the case on the part of the orthodox scientist. But the more advanced of the workers in the ranks of modern science do not hesitate to positively assert the presence of conscious intelligent activity in plant life and vigorously support their contention by logical argument, backed up by incontrovertible facts gleaned in their laboratory experiments. These scientists hold that the presence of the phenomena of nutrition, reproduction, and of physical and chemical change due to adaptation is proof positive of the presence of vital intelligence within the organism in which the former are manifested.
Professor Beiser says, adaptation, after all, is the best evidence of the presence of intelligence or life in forms or units of matter. Adaptation, also called physiological adaptation, but best called psychological adaptation, is the one weapon by which living organisms fight against the destructive forces of conditions of nature. In all its forms, adaptation is the more or less successful cooperation of living organisms with the laws of nature. It is not the disregard of natural laws. In taking adaptation as our criterion by which the presence of intelligence is determined, we find no difficulty in settling the question of the presence of life.
The most perfect automatic machinery has no life because it cannot adapt itself in the least to the changing environmental conditions and thus save itself from annihilation when necessity arises by the performance of simple intelligent acts. In their consideration of the question of the presence of consciousness in the kingdom of plant life, the writers divide the manifestations of intelligence into three classes, namely, trophoses, or acts pertaining to nutrition, neuroses, or acts pertaining to the nervous system, and psychoses, or acts pertaining to thought processes. The manifestation of trophoses, or acts pertaining to nutrition, is apparent even in the case of the lowest forms of plant life. Even the lowliest vegetable cell takes nourishment and replaces the waste products of its system by fresh material taken into its system.
These activities require a very simple nervous system, often practically no nervous system at all. but nevertheless, in every act of nutrition, there is manifested not only the presence of life, but also conscious activity of a certain degree. Even the lowest forms of plants are able to distinguish perfectly between nutritive and non-nutritive particles of matter. Most plants possess no nervous system, at least none yet discovered by science. But, nevertheless, they manifest characteristic trophoses corresponding in degree with their necessities, but seldom exceeding those necessities.
Other plants, however, have a comparatively highly developed nervous system, or something corresponding to it, and manifest neuroses, or acts pertaining to the nervous system, of a comparatively high degree. This is true of the sensitive plants, and certain other plants of a high development in this direction. Some of the orchids and a few other plants manifest neuroses indicating clearly the presence of consciousness and a degree of intelligent activity. Still higher in the scale, we find certain species of plants manifesting true psychoses or acts pertaining to thought processes, although the latter are of a comparatively low order as compared to those manifested by the higher forms of animal life. With this class of manifestation, the average student is not so well informed, and, therefore, it has been thought well to direct your attention in the following pages to these fascinating phenomena of plant life.
We think that a careful consideration of the facts now about to be presented to the student will bring him a clear realization of the presence of actual conscious activity in the kingdom of the plants, and will cause him to accept the statement of that eminent authority, Professor Beiser, who has said, "While we believe that the intelligence of man, animals, and plants is essentially the same kind, we know that it differs enormously in degree and form. Even among men, this degree of intelligence varies, but this is because some individuals by nature see but a little more clearly their needs than others, and live under more favorable circumstances. That is all."
Dr. J. E. Taylor, an authority on the subject of plant psychology, says, "Perhaps one reason why plants are usually denied consciousness and intelligence is because in the structure of even the highest developed species we find no specialized nervous tract along which sensations may travel, or where they can be registered as in the case of the ganglia and brains of the higher animals. But it should be remembered that none of the creatures, subkingdom of the protozoa, the lowest of the grand divisions of the animal kingdom, possess nervous structures, whilst many of the next more highly organized animal subkingdom, the coelenterata, have no trace, and the rest but a feeble development. Yet we do not deny these lowly organized animals a dim and diffused consciousness, or even the possibility of their structures being so modified that they can profit by experience and thus develop that accumulated experience of their kind that we call instinct."
Darwin, speaking of the wonderful sensitiveness of the root tip of plants, says, "It is hardly an exaggeration to say that the tip of the radicle thus endowed and having the power of directing the movements of the adjoining parts acts like the brain of one of the lower animals, the brain being seated within the anterior end of the body, receiving impressions from these sense organs and directing the general movements." Professor Cope says, "We can understand how by parasitism or other means of getting a livelihood without exertion, the adoption of new and skillful movements would become unnecessary and consciousness itself would be seldom aroused. Continued repose would be followed by subconsciousness and later by unconsciousness. Such appears to be the history of the entire vegetable kingdom." Enlightened viewers, we appreciate your gentle company for today's episode of Between Master and Disciples. Join us again next Wednesday for part 3 of The Secret Doctrine of the Rosicrucians, The Planes of Consciousness. Please stay tuned to Supreme Master Television for Planet Earth, our loving home, coming up next after Noteworthy News. Wishing you much blessings from all beings on our planet.
For more details, please visit www.suprememastertv.com/BMD.